Hi, everyone. Welcome to our packages book club within the data science learning community. I think I have that right. We're going over the R packages book. And this week we're going over chapter 18, other markdown files. I imagine that this will probably be a shorter week. There wasn't a ton of information covered in this chapter, but there was some good information. So these are some of our learning objectives that we are going to go over. We'll learn what README and news markdown files are, what information to include, who the files are targeted towards, and then what useless functions we can use to automate the creation of those. So this is the other documentation that you should include in your package. And those are the README and the news markdown files. They don't have to be in markdown, but it's strongly recommended. I think that's because it's able to display in GitHub, and if you submit to CRAN, it will display there as well. So there's definitely some benefits for using the markdown format. So what is a README? You may be familiar with it outside of R. It's not just an R concept, but similar to the description file, it is like a software engineering concept. And basically it's used to help orient someone get familiar with a package. So it's targeted towards a new user for that package. And like I mentioned earlier, README file is important for CRAN, GitHub, and if you have a package down site for your package as well. So these go back even back to the 70s. So here's a file, here's an example of what that looks like. In this case, it's a readme.txt. I like how it says good luck as well. In essence, README file, for anyone who comes across it, it's a high-level description of the package. It might include a couple simple examples, how to install the package as well, and then an overview of the main components. It's definitely, I would say that the high level description and how to install it are probably the most important parts of a README. And then having examples is very helpful as well. The Tidyverse team does a really good job with the README files for their packages. Here is dplyr The README shows up on the front page of the GitHub for dplyr. And you can see here, if someone's new to this, they actually have a hex sticker too, but it includes a basic overview, some of the more popular functions within the package, links to Go for more information within R for data science, some more back-end information. Perhaps you're looking to use it with other packages and other backends. How to install it, and how to install the development version. And then I think for the most part, most of the tidyverse packages also come with a cheat sheet as well. So good overview on how to utilize the package. And then just a basic couple of examples as well. If you have a particular package that you want to share and look over during today's meeting, feel free to put it in the chat and we can look at the README together.
Yeah, I would say that if there are some weird cross-platform issues, they need to be mentioned, that if there are external dependencies like Java or whatever, then the users should be instructed how to install them.
Yeah, that's a good point. I'm trying to think of one off the top of my head that would have those external dependencies.
Well, some of the machine learning stuff does, like, I don't know, XGBoost, I think, relies on Java or C++ on the line. And so C++ is fine, it's going to be covering, but some packages require. So H2O requires Java. And some of the configurations, H2O doesn't work by itself. You need to run it as a cluster, the machine learning library. So there are, H2O, I don't think it goes. They probably encourage you to download from their own H2O.ai website, whatever the feature. Yeah, I think DPI has some slight oddities as well, because it needs to talk with all the SQL engines.
Oh, here's the CRAN for H2O. Where's the README? There's the news file. Maybe.
They don't like ship the README with the package, but you can go to that main URL for package, and it has an extensive README. Go back from here.
Within here, or back on the CRAN.
That one. No, stop right there.
Here.
And scroll down. And then you can keep scrolling down forever after the files, because like there's just scroll down a little more and you can see the table of contents. Like they have chapters in their README.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, it shows how to set up on the different systems. That's very, that's impressive.
Well, it's a complicated system.
Yeah,
I would say. Yeah, so that's probably a lot more intensive than the typical README, I would say. But yeah, it's good to see. It's good to see that explanation of installing with different systems. Yeah, I'm sure that's not the only one either.
Well, I mean, having 15,000 issues on GitHub, that's a big number.
Yeah, that that's big for sure. I bet there's like analytics to like see where that ranks compared to like other packages, but I would assume that it's towards the top. Yes, compared to dplyr, which has like 63 open issues. I am curious, since we just had the Shiny conference, what this looks like. Okay, Shiny has like almost 800 issues. An overview.
Well, I mean, I'm looking at the max number. So the commit messages for H2O referencing issues like GH 15,000 something, and here I see the 4,000 something. I mean, this is, well, that's still number that only a package with like 20 developers can manage. So any single developer who has more than, I don't know, 15 open issues would probably be overwhelmed.
Posit tends to break their stuff up a lot too. Like, they don't overload the README. They have the next chapter that they have full websites for all their packages. So the README is really just kind of the introduction to the website.
Yeah, that's a good point. Like, especially for Shiny, like,
yeah,
they're like, go to the user gallery, go to the book or the tutorial. That definitely a good point.
And also for things like H2O is built across R and Python, and they may have a custom documentation build system.
Yeah.
So they have the C++ underlying engine, and they probably use Jenkins to build everything. And so it's not a single readme.md to GitHub process.
Yeah, that's definitely a good point. Cool. Well, if anyone has other packages that they want to take a look at during or at the end, feel free to put that in the chat.
It depends on time.
Depends on?
On particular, so you need to start Python to use SQL charts. See the ground link.
Oh, Is this it? Okay, so there's the two different versions, Python and R. Then I think they... Yeah, it looks like they have some Python examples and R examples, or... at least calling it from R, so that's pretty cool. Sweet. Cool. I'll go ahead and keep going. So we talked about the markdown files. There's also RMD files as well. The markdown or MD plays nicely with CRAN, GitHub, and package down sites. However, as our README file should include examples, a RMD file would also allow us to run R code. One way to do this is to use an RMD file as the main source file, which can then be rendered into an MD file. And I forget which, I think it's the MD file that they tell you not to directly edit. It's the RMD file. I may have that switched around. And as usual, there is a handy function in the use this package, use this, use README RMD, which will allow you to use the RMD file.
Yeah, the idea is you edit in the RMD and then that renders into MD. So only ever edit the RMD if you use RMD. Technically, don't, you know, like only use the RMD if you're going to use R code in your README. But that said, I always just use an RMD in case, like if I want to demo something, obviously that would be the way to do it.
That makes sense. Yeah. So this, this function creates a README RMD file template. And the file has a YAML header, which outputs into a GitHub document. I think this is just saying what a GitHub document is. All the different extensions and options that come with it. The README RMD file adds the file to our build ignore as we just want our README markdown included. If we need to make the changes to the README file, we edit the RMD file and render it with DevTools. So that's where don't edit it by hand comes in. if your package is also a Git repo, then there's a neat pre-commit hook that compares the RMD to the MD file, and it'll warn you if it's out of date or not. By showing that warning. The other markdown file is the news markdown, where the README is aimed at new users. This one is aimed at existing users, for informing them of updates of your package. It's basically a change log showing any changes a user might want to find out about. And like the README, it's recommended that they use markdown files. And it also comes with a handy use this function as well. And then it will generate a news markdown file for you. Many other lifecycle and release related functions in the DevTools ecosystem will make appropriate changes to news.md as your package evolves. Stas asks, are there Git hooks, GitHub actions to issue warnings if you bump the version but did not document in news markdown? go ahead, John.
I'm sorry, I didn't have anything to add. Didn't okay. mean to clear my throat there.
I'm not sure about that. I would imagine so. It feels like you can do a lot of things with GitHub Actions that I'm not entirely familiar with.
I think because news is only for user-facing changes, I don't think that they have anything to make sure, because I think they make too many changes that are just like a refactor or, you know, cleaning something up under the hood, basically, that they wouldn't tell, that they wouldn't put in news. But it would be good, I think.
As I understand, what they have is a rule that avoid that after you change your markdown file and don't update the markdown file, you should get a message before committing. But no, at the level, you don't know that it was changes. Yeah. And we don't, as John explained it, maybe you are making a refactor and those doesn't add any value, you know, you're like making more readable the code, no changing anything for the end user.
Okay. Yeah, GitHub Actions are a mystery to me.
That maybe could be a good task for ChatGPT to read the changes and try to figure out the news and the more the channel, now, you know? Maybe the tutorial no that way. But at least the news.
That could be a good R package. So how to structure your news files. Use the top level heading for each version, the most recent at the top. Each change should be in a bulleted list. And if there's a lot of changes, use a subheading. this one's probably important if it's related to GitHub issue or a pull request, include the number so you can tag to it and readers can connect the dots and see what it's fixing. So it's easier to follow along for the end user. And include username as well.
It's not in part of the description as a contributor.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, especially if they're not a contributor in the description, as Angel said. And this, here's an example. It includes the version number as well. And then it, you can break it up into major changes and minor changes. I think they said for their development purposes, they usually just have a like running list, and then when they do push the updates to news, they'll actually sort it before publishing and get it all divided into the different categories.
I think to me the most important one have been the breaking changes. Mm. I was using a package, it was in an early development state. And when I was trying to date the package, nothing works. So I need really to read the breaking changes to understand why my code is not working anymore.
Yeah, that's probably the most important piece of the news descriptions. And a big reason for keeping up to date with that. So get in the habit of keeping your news up to date. It can be hard to remember to do that. Use release issue will remind you to polish the news file. And using your version control system, get diff, for example, to compare between your current version and past release can help prompt you for those differences and what to include in that news file. Sweet. I thought there were, I think the book might link to the news file for dplyr. I just wanted to show what that looked like as well. So yeah, we have the version number, and then each one links to the respective issue. This user must not be one of the contributors in the description. And then, oh, I think this one is the top one development. Because this one says CRAN release 2023. And then 1.14 looks like perhaps the current version. I'm curious. Oh, there we go. Yeah, so 1.10 was a major update for dplyr. It shows the lifecycle changes and goes over the breaking changes as well. And then explains the deprecated functions and then some of the other major changes as well. Yeah, that one, this one looks like a much bigger update. They went from 1.01 to 1.1. So when you have that bigger increment, it usually involves more changes. Sweet. So that's all I had for today. Are there any comments or questions? If not, that's okay. This week was fairly straightforward. Next week we are finishing up the documentation portion of this book, and then we have like five more chapters, or then we have four more chapters for maintenance and distribution for your package. If no one else wants to present, I will be presenting again next week.
I went ahead and took it. So,
oh, you did?
You're clear. Yep.
Okay, awesome. I think we may have one more. Let me go here. Someone does want to present on the last week. We do have one more slot available. Otherwise, we should be good for the next few weeks. All right. Rebecca has a question. What's the easiest way to find the release date for a package version?
I know that's really tangential, but it's something that bothers me when I'm looking at news or whatever. Like, when did this?
I'm not sure.
Stas has an answer. Okay. Am I the only one who's bought it? And I'm like, how long has this been feature been around? And I'm like, I have no, like, yes, I could.
So, but you can, if you want the like CRAN dates, you can go to the, what do they call it? Is it old sources in CRAN? And it'll give you an archive with all the dates that things, were on CRAN, like when they were released.
Okay.
And then if you go to GitHub, let me see, they should have it in tags. Yeah. So this is something people have to remember to do, but the Tidyverse team does it.
Yeah. Okay. That's definitely an argument for tags. Cool. Thanks.
Yes. You're welcome.
I like seeing that.
Are tags covered? Did we cover that in our packages?
It might be in chapter 20, software development practices.
Okay.
Or actually, it could even be in 22, because that is one of the things on their checklist, is to make a tag. I don't remember.
Okay, that seems like a useful practice.
Yeah, and it's easy to forget. So if if you use all the use this tools, they walk you through doing that. But I don't know, it's an easy one to skip over.
Groundhog that I mentioned is the tool to manage dependencies that a specific date, right? So we used to have the Microsoft Time Machine, which went down a year and a half ago. So, and Groundhog is kind of it was kind of put together as a quick fix, and it kind of stuck to some extent, I think. So it runs the metadatabase of what's on CRAN, what version was archived at what time, maybe back to like 2017, not all the way to 2002 or whatever, but a few years back. Yeah, and it there's a specific RDS file that's softly exposed. If you'll read the Groundhog documentation very carefully, you'll find a specific link on Groundhog website. And it would have the release dates together with the version numbers. So it obviously uses that internally when you specify Groundhog this from November 20th, 2023. It will look up the previously available version. So there's some functionality to do that.
I haven't played with it, but the POSIT public package manager is supposed to let you do like snapshots by day as well.
Yeah, it doesn't do this by day. I don't think it does.
There's snapshots, yes, always install package from date I choose, and you can choose a date.
Okay. Well, okay. I had somewhat better luck with Groundhog. It was producing more consistent answers. And our organization is too poor to afford the proper package manager.
That's why they made the public version. Like, it doesn't have every day in all of history, but it's got a lot of dates. And actually, I think they've started doing pretty much every weekday.
Okay, I'll check it out again.
One final question. Did we have a use this book club at all, or was there something similar to that?
We did. So there are videos, and one of these days I'm gonna like kind of revamp the plan of how to do it and get someone to launch that again. And if you want to do it, you know, push me, because it's very useful. That was a really useful club. I learned a lot.
Cool. I'll check those videos out, and I'll be on the lookout for if there's another cohort for that.
Cool.
Awesome. Well, thank you, everyone. We're in the home stretch now, just a few more weeks. So I'll see y'all next week.
Thank you for leading again.